Thanks so much, Alan. And the first thing I should mention, as Alan said, the lead person on this part of the water quality, the work that we've been engaged in here at RFF, is actually Jishang Shi, my colleague, an RFF fellow who's sitting in the second row. So if there are questions about the data as we get into it, we'll do kind of a combination. I'll answer some, and then I'll deflect some to Jishang. But then lots of other folks, as for every project that we've been talking about today on the team, including Lucia, Zian Chu, the intrepid RA, and intrepid, you'll understand why I use that word when I describe the data that we're using for this, Alan himself, and then two colleagues at Yale that Alan mentioned earlier, Jim Sayers, a hydrologist, and Shimi Annisfeld, an aquatic chemist, have been helping us look at these data and understand them better since we're all essentially economists and have less training than would be desirable to look at some of the data we'll be talking about today. So as Alan mentioned, the surface water quality impacts of shale gas development really came out of the expert survey as an important concern, and then we were able to demonstrate empirically that some of those concerns, such as accidental releases from well sites, might be less of concern than you might think, since we were able to show in Pennsylvania that we didn't see any systematic evidence of that kind of impact on rivers and streams. But then we were able to show empirically that other things, like the shipment of flowback and produced water to wastewater treatment facilities, both municipal and chemical waste treatment facilities, was potentially a concern. We were showing some impacts there. And so we took that particular pathway, the wastewater treatment pathway, which came out of both the survey and the PNAS work, as being potentially important. And in order to try and get our kind of hands a little bit better around the question of what kind of a risk this represents, we went after what we know to be the only publicly available data, at least as far as we know, on the characteristics of these wastewater streams that are being treated. And again, this is a problem that's somewhat specific to the Marcellus shale region, less of a concern for shales in the west, where deep injection of these wastes is the primary disposal mechanism, but where we do have states that are engaging in some of these shipments of waste to waste treatment facilities, this kind of analysis will be relevant to those states. And again, we're working in Pennsylvania because, as Alan said, thanks to Michael Kranzer and others at the DEP, there's a ton of data available on these kinds of issues in Pennsylvania, and so we were able to take advantage of that. So again, the purpose of the work is to do some statistical analysis of the characteristics, specific characteristics of flowback and produced water and drilling fluid waste, so three major categories of liquid wastes. Okay, there are also solid waste and other visitor wastes that are generated by operators in the Marcellus Shale. We're not looking at those. We're just focusing on these liquid categories. And approximately what we're going to be looking at is between 2008 and 2011. I say approximately for a reason that will be obvious when I talk about the reporting requirement behind the main piece of data that we're going to be using to support the work. And we do this because if the sort of recycling of this waste, the treatment disposal options involve some exposure to the environment, to human health, the knowledge of the wastewater constituents is going to help us to quantify those risks in the long run. So we think of the results of this work as being potentially useful in several ways. One would be in evaluating the current and future wastewater treatment technologies and infrastructure capacity and siting of those facilities. There's some geographic component to what we're doing, is what we'll talk about in a minute. And also understanding the potential impacts of those treated wastewater flows on rivers and streams to a greater extent than we do currently, and potentially in setting effluent standards for the industry through processes at the state level or like what's underway currently at EPA. For the federal level. In terms of other folks that have looked at this question, there are certainly some papers appearing in the literature, including our recent one, just focusing on this question of whether these wastewater flows are having impacts, how large the wastewater treatment and disposal capacity is in Pennsylvania compared with the flows that have been increasing from oil and gas industry there as a result of shale gas development. But specifically on the wastewater constituents, we know of kind of two main databases, neither of which, to our knowledge, are publicly available, although it would be interesting to talk with folks here if people know differently. There's some nice work that was funded by the Marcellus Shale Coalition and others, where they did some consistent sampling from 19 different well locations, and the analyses are all performed by a single lab, and they get flowback samples sort of starting at day one and then going out 90 days into development. And so that's a really nice data set as far as we can tell. We don't see at least yet any publications available to tell us what the results of that were, but there are some nice PowerPoint slides and other things on the web. If you went to search using some of these phrases in Google, you'll find that there are these data out there, and there's some analysis going on. We also understand that GE has a database of wastewater constituents, sort of representative from various shales. Again, the advantage of what we're doing, we think, is that the data in our analysis are publicly available to some extent. I'll talk about the complications and access to the data in just a minute. And that we focus on the waste that's sent to treatment facilities because that this is basically what triggers the reporting requirement in Pennsylvania. And as you know, there are many different pathways for waste that are generated from a shale gas well. You can recycle them and you know, clean them up a little bit, you frack the next well, and go on and on with that. You can send them to deep injection facilities. Mostly this is happening from the wells in the southwestern part of the state going into Ohio, for example. So, you know, to the extent that the wastewater treatment shipments are different from these other pathways, then our results would be somewhat different from other analyses of wastewater constituents as well. We don't really know that because we don't have, samples of wastewater that went to deep injection or went to recycling. Okay. And then finally, we have several categories of types of waste within this waste stream, including drilling fluid waste and some other categories that are going to be a little bit different probably from the focus on flowback and produced water, at least in the Marcellus Shale Coalition study that we are aware of. Okay, so I mentioned the primary data source. The primary data source is something called the Form 26R, okay, which is submitted to the Pennsylvania Department of Environmental Protection, or the DEP, by residual waste generators in the state. And there's a quantity threshold. Okay, I'll talk about that. I'll kind of come back here in a minute. But basically, the form is going to have some basic information about the generator, okay, description of the waste, what it looks like, its physical appearance, pH range, simple things that you can do without sort of sending it out to a lab. And then importantly for our analysis, there's actually a requirement to attach a lab analysis done at a state-certified lab of the chemical constituents in the wastewater. And then there's some process description requirements and, some information about the waste treatment facility or disposal facility that's used, which is also important for analysis, and then a certification section. When is the form required? Well, any firm that generates more than 2,200 pounds of residual waste from a single generating location, which in the case of shale gas is going to mean basically a single site. So if you talk to folks at the DEP, they'll say, well, that's the, set of wells on a well pad plus, kind of affiliated infrastructure at the same site, storage tanks, impoundments, and so on that might be associated with all of those wells. In a single month during the calendar year, has to file this form and the attached chemical analysis by March 1st of the following year. Okay, and here we're talking about non-hazardous industrial waste. That's not to say that none of the constituents within the waste are could potentially be hazardous, but legally, right, this is not designated as hazardous waste and requiring disposal in a hazardous waste facility, but something that can be treated at a wastewater treatment plant or in the case of solid waste disposed of at a landfill and so on. And then an individual chemical analysis is required for each waste type that contributes to that 2,200-pound threshold. Okay, so the DEP has these waste codes, and I've just copied from their kind of waste code catalog just the set of codes that are particularly relevant to shale gas development. And in our analysis, we're focusing on these codes with the numbers are 802, 803, 804. That's not terribly important. But basically, the first category, number 802, is brine. That's just the definition in the DEP document. You want to think about that basically as produced water. Okay. The second, 803, is drilling fluid waste. And then the third, 804, is the category called fracking fluid waste, but this is basically going to mostly we'll be talking about flowback. Okay, now you may be well aware of the idea that the kind of dividing line between flowback and produced water may be somewhat fluid, so to speak. It was apparent to us in looking at these forms that sometimes, right, an operator might not know, is this 802, is this 804? You know, there's probably some mixing of those. We're going to analyze them as separate categories, but understand that there's not really necessarily a clear dividing line between the two. And then if you are an operator in Marcellus Shale and the residual waste is coming from a shale gas well, there is a long list of required analytes or the chemicals that you need to test for in the attached chemical analysis or that the lab needs to test for in the attached analysis. And this is the list, okay, so it's a long one. And then there's, of course, a note that says, in addition, you have to test for other stuff that you, the operator, know or suspect could be present in the wastewater. And the idea here is that not just that you're going to sort of send this form to the DEP once per year, but that it's going to provide important information for the operator of the wastewater treatment facility that's receiving the waste about what they need to be thinking about in the treatment process. So data collection. Lucia mentioned earlier, right, the sort of pain of going to data that are in PDF form, and anyone here who works with data would sort of understand the pain involved in something like that. And it may be that the property value study is not going down that road because we have learned our lesson from this from this study. But in any case, what we did is the, as I said, intrepid RA Xian Chu spent a lot of quality time in the regional offices of the DEP, and folks there were extremely helpful to us. And what we did is we picked up these, the forms are filed in hard copy, okay, by each operator. And so we picked up every form that was available from what was known or sort of suspected to be a Marcellus shale gas operator. By the time it was, let's see, Jessica was out there in between fall and winter of sort of 2011, 2012. And we went to the four regional offices where there's a lot of shale gas development going on, so we would expect to find a lot of those forms. And you can see that 74 of them came from the southwest region, 11 from northwest, 85 from the north central region, and then 8 from the northeastern region. And we didn't go to the other two regional offices. We may have missed a few. But in general, what she was doing was taking a portable document scanner, scanning in these forms to PDF, then translating them from PDF into Excel, doing a massive cleaning effort, right, where you had everything from things that didn't get sort of read incorrectly, you know, into the PDF and going back to the forms and hand-entering numbers, to understanding that different labs might use different units or different testing protocols, and trying to standardize all of that stuff so that we could come up with a decent sample of individual sort of unique samples of wastewater flows, either flowback, produced water, or drilling fluid waste, so that we could analyze them statistically. And at the end of the day, she came back with almost 1,200 such forms. Many of them were solid waste forms, so again, you know, sort of put those aside. We're not doing anything with those right now. But of the forms that sort of fell into those categories that I showed you earlier of drilling waste or produced water or flowback, and were not duplicates. So if you're an operator and you're sending waste to multiple plants, you could send the same chemical analysis out. And we had to kind of sort through and understand which ones are duplicates and throw those out. And once we did all of that and a bunch of other stuff, we come up with 178 unique samples, okay, from 22 different firms, from 104 identifiable wells. Obviously, there are some forms where you can't necessarily tell exactly what well the sample comes from. And then we got, to the extent that we could, location information on the wastewater treatment facilities, treating the waste and the wells and so on. You can see the distribution across years down at the bottom. And the reason I say there's sort of some uncertainty about the particular year, the sort of start point, is that you could imagine that in 2009 we still had some forms coming in from 2008 samples because they weren't due until March 1st of the following year and so on. Okay, so our stop point is 2011 for sure, but our start point probably includes some data from 2008 as well as 2009. In terms of categories of chemicals, again, you had that list from the DEP of the required testing, but we actually find lab samples that are tested for a total of 432 different analytes in categories including general chemicals, organics, pesticides, metals, radioactive materials. But only 198 of them are actually measured in at least one sample. Lots of sort of not assessed or not detected or below detection limits. That'll be a complication of the analysis, as I'll talk about in just a minute. And then I like when Alan called the statistical work in the original water quality study that we did, the PNAS study, fancy, because it's always nice to have fancy statistics. The work in this study is going to be very different, so we're not sort of testing causal hypotheses the way Lucia described in the property value study or the way Alan talked about in the water quality study that we've done. This is going to be primarily a descriptive exercise, trying to understand what is in the wastewater and why we might be either worried or not worried about that. And what I'm showing here, these are just two graphs from that category of general chemicals. And on the left-hand side, there's first chloride, then total dissolved solids, then sulfate, and then bromide. In the water quality study we did earlier, we worried about chloride. Okay, there's the very high levels of salts, dissolved salts in particular, in the brine and flowback from the shale gas wells. And that can be something that's particularly difficult for treatment facilities to get out. And so what we're showing here is the green graphs are basically the category that the DEP waste code calls fracking fluid waste, but we think of that as basically flowback. And the blue is brine or produced water. You know, sort of seeing the blues generally above the greens. These are what are called box and whisker plots. I had to practice that three times this morning. It's not bosque and whisker, box and whisker. And the top line, right, that's the top line and the bottom line are basically the sort of top point and bottom point of each line are telling you the maximum and the minimum concentration that we observed of that chemical in all of the samples for which the chemical was tested. And then the colored piece in the middle is kind of, it's showing you what we would call the interquartile distribution, or the, where the bulk of the distribution lies. Okay, so the top of the box in the middle is going to be the 75th percentile observation. The bottom is the 25th percentile. And the line in the middle is the median, okay, or the value above which half of the distribution lies and below which half of the distribution lies. So you're sort of looking at those kind of color pieces and you're saying, well, you know, in general, the produced water is going to be higher in some of these general chemicals, dissolved chemicals, than the flowback is. That's not surprising to operators or to wastewater treatment operators either, right? But there's that pattern shows up and you'd want it to if you want to sort of worried about the categorizations that I was talking about earlier, that line between flowback and produced water. And then another thing that one could do would be to compare the levels that we see in the raw wastewater, or the untreated wastewater, to interesting kind of grappling points or sort of way of thinking about this from a public policy perspective. So things like the Pennsylvania State wastewater effluent standards, right? How high above the wastewater effluent standards are the water wastewater values, or how high above drinking water standards are they? And so we're doing some of that as well. And we can do that for lots of different categories. So metals are something that that others have raised as issues. We see things like barium, strontium, chromium, cadmium. Barium and strontium in particular are tested for a lot. We see lots of values, so we can do some nice descriptive work there. Organics, that's one of the hardest parts of what we're doing. When I mentioned those 400 some odd chemicals, a huge number of those are organic chemicals that, you know, might show up. You have lots of options, right? If you're using an organic chemical for something, very small change causes a change in the chemical name, but it may not cause a functional change or a big functional change in what you're actually using it for. So we have a sort of proliferation of the number of organic chemicals in the data set. We're sort of trying to figure out exactly what to focus on, but obviously some would be more important than others, BTEX or the kind of benzene, toluene, ethylene, xylene. We're going to be looking at chemicals like that and doing similar kind of comparison. And then finally, another thing people have worried about are norms or naturally occurring radioactive materials that are entrained right in the fluids as they come back out of the well that has been, you know, the water that's been down in the deep shale formation. Radium-226 and radium-228 are two such substances that we see tested for a lot in these wastewaters. And you can see Jisheng has put the drinking water MCL down there at the bottom, and then you can see the distributions that we observe in both flowback and produced water for both of these chemicals are well above that level. And so, again, just emphasizing the need for effective treatment. We can also do some interesting geographic work. I won't get into this terribly much, but understand that the size of the circles here indicates the concentrations of chloride. So a big circle is a high concentration, a small circle is a low concentration, coming out of individual wells that we're able to identify and attach to these unique samples. And then the size of the triangles is matched in color. So the triangle is a wastewater treatment facility treating, so the blue triangle on the left there is treating waste from those blue circle wells. So understand that you may have high concentrations coming out of a well in one location, but the treatment and then release to rivers and streams is actually occurring in another location entirely. So we're going to be trying to do some of those interesting geographic work as well. Some preliminary conclusions, right? So obviously this is wastewater, so you have to see high chemical concentrations pre-treatment, emphasizing that need for effective treatment. I give you some examples there with barium and chlorides and so on. Importantly, the wastewater composition is highly variable over the course of the shale gas extraction process. So sometimes we actually know how many days after fracking, for example, the sample was taken. And we see exactly the reason why I think the Marcellus Shale Coalition work looks at right many different endpoints or sort of date points after the fracking is done. Which is that it changes a lot. And I think that's a big challenge for effective treatment and management. So remember, this is the public reporting requirement, so we're using the publicly available data. If I'm an operator, I file this once per year, right, per generating location, but my wastewater stream could be changing quite dramatically even within a period of days, right, and so the information that I'm receiving as the waste treatment operator, right, may not be keeping up with that that very sort of dynamic process of the change in the wastewater constituents. Obviously, produced water is different than flowback. We're seeing higher levels of many different types of constituents, different, more difficult to recycle, and so on. Many of these constituents can and are being effectively removed by the chemical waste treatment facilities that are currently treating the waste. Metals would be a good example of that generally. Others, of course, not so much. Salts, that's been a big concern. And so further research on the potential risks from treatment and release to rivers and streams, right, certainly identified in the survey as important, identified in our PNAS work as important, and then again here sort of emphasizing an important potential risk pathway that is warranting further research.